in the middle of a waterfall. It's noisy, it's messy, it's colorful, it's weird to see everything's falling down. Suddenly it stops. The jets are coming down, you see a bit of splashes, you're standing there in the darkness on a black mirror. That's how it feels when the doctor tells you you have leukemia. On February 24 this year, I was urgently hospitalized because I was developing bruises all over my body. I started bleeding in my mouth. The doctor said, go to the hospital, Tom. We have to examine. At midnight, I got the infamous bad news delivery by the doctor that I have acute leukemia of the quite rare kind. It's called APL, which is not very common, but it's very lethal. So usually you don't survive 2 weeks with this, unless, of course, the treatment works. So that's what happened. They immediately gave me blood transfusions and chemotherapy. And luckily, after a few days, I was recovering. So I quickly moved from the critical phase to the phase of that you might get cured. 4 weeks later, I was released from the hospital. I was strong enough to join the rest of the world in the lockdown, staying at home. After 5 weeks, I had my first bone marrow test, which was extremely good. And cancer was in remission, the doctor said. So we are going to take you to the next phase to cure you fully. And that's called the maintenance phase. So, well, a little bit of maintenance, right? But then she said, well, it actually is 7 months of treatment in which you have to be 4 months in hospital. Not full time, but imagine in the afternoon you go to the hospital, they hook you up with a bag of poison, you wait 3 hours, you get sick, you go home, go to bed in the morning, you feel a little bit better. And in the afternoon you go back to the hospital, they hook you up and you get sick again. That's for 4 weeks. Then you got 4 weeks to recover. Another 4 weeks, you're getting sick. You got 4 weeks to recover. Another 4 weeks, you get sick. Another 4 weeks to recover. Another 4 weeks to get sick. And that was last Friday, the last of the chemotherapies. And then this morning, I went to the doctor again to discuss the tests I had. And luckily, my blood is fantastic. The bone marrow was looking really good. I could be declared cured, but there was one little test that is still waiting. There's a DNA test, which would take another 2 weeks to get. But the doctor said, I shouldn't worry about that. I'm recovering extremely well. So basically, I've got my life back. So, and oh, how much I would have loved to celebrate that today at the conference with everyone. But there would have been a conference and we would have thrown an enormous party. Not this year. So I'm telling you this because this whole experience had a profound impact on me, on my personality and on my life, of course. Lots of time to think. And I learned a couple of lessons. First, getting cancer and surviving it is not a fight. It's not something you win or something you lose. You only need one thing. A little bit of discipline, of course. Take care of yourself. Eat well. Do some exercises. But what you need is luck. And I was lucky. I was lucky that science found the right treatment for me, which is only 15 years old, this treatment for people with this type of leukemia. I was lucky to have family and friends around me to stand by. And I was lucky to have a team here in the company to stand by and to have Francesco Cedi to replace me for 8 months, doing a fantastic job on it. So I was lucky to live in the Netherlands, where there is a universal healthcare for everyone. So there was not a moment that I had to worry about what the treatment would cost. And the doctors didn't have one moment to think other than what can we do for Tom to help him, to cure him, and to make it as good and easy as possible for him. So next time if you see people having cancer, don't wish them strength. waarin dat sterkte. Dat zei good luck and I wish you well, or a good day and a good evening. One of the things I learned was that I want to start taking care better of myself. And I want to had the feeling that I was sacrificing myself too much. So I want to put myself more forward and also take care better of myself in a way that I can pay myself a little bit better so I can afford, for example, a little house outside of Amsterdam with a garden. I also mentioned last year that at some moment I have to step aside from Brandenburg for the future and to allow other people to come in. And that process is being sped up, but not so much that I want to step down, but to get very strong people around me to help making Blender strong and keep it strong so that I can move on and step forward. Because the main thing I learned was that I was really, really not ready to let it go. I learned, couldn't let go of Blender because that's my life's work. Blender is life, right? Blender is the community, it's the team of people here, it's everybody who's contributing, it's the developers, the bug fixers, it's the people who make add-ons, it's even the people who complain, or the people who use Maya and don't like Blender, it's the forum trolls, and it's even the people who want to have the game engine back. So all of them are the people I love, and all of them I feel like is my family. And I will never let go of that family. So, enough drama, right? I want to end a little bit with a more happy note. As we all know, 2020 is not very nice. It's a year we are going to forget. But the happy message is that 2020 didn't get me down. And I want to spread that positive vibe to everyone. So please take care of yourself, take care of each other, a little bit of Blender, and I see you next year in Amsterdam or somewhere else. Bye-bye. Cut.